Mobile is the oldest of them. It does not allow two-way binding. So if you have a variable that is an input and you want to display it somewhere else on the page, then you have to manually update both. Second thing I don't like about it is that it is very difficult to make it look good. It always looks like amateur hour, no matter what you're doing. So tried it a couple of times, didn't really get anywhere, and the clients were not happy with the look and feel. So for the purpose of this, we are going to do Ionic. We are going to call this app Morgan Solis. And you've got a couple of options on how you originally set up the pages. You can change this later on once you're in the project, but this gives you kind of a quick start. So it's always a good idea to have an understanding of more or less how you want the app to look. Blank means it's just got one screen and that's it. There's no sidebar menu, there's no top bar menu, and there's no bottom bars. Tabs. Is it gives you a set of tabs at the bottom that you can configure. Side menu is one of those flyout menus on the side. The difference for me, if you're only going to have four or five options on the app, then go with a tab menu at the bottom. You can show and hide it as you need it. If you're going to have more than five options, rather go with a side menu because then you can have as many options as you want. It does require a bit more configuration, but it works pretty well. So for the purpose of this, we're going to go side menu because I know the Morgan Solis app is going to grow into quite a beast. There is a lot of internal customer information we are going to want to federate to the app, and we're going to want to do a lot of functions on it. So it does kind of make sense to go with this one. So once you create it, Appery sets up a nice IDE for you. Now, what makes this IDE different from other IDEs is that the graphical interface is drag and drop. And I find that to be a huge advantage. I have not found any other IDE that works as efficiently as this one. On the left-hand side, you've got project. So this is your general project setup information. Under that, you've got your app settings. So your app settings is where you set up what type of an app this is. In other words, what's its name? Are you going to do an Android app? Are you going to do an iOS app? And are you going to do a progressive web app? Nice thing about this is you can do all three using the exact same code base, and that's the beauty about it. So the app name is Morgan Solis. We don't have to change anything there. The resources is the various libraries that are used by the underlying app. If you want to publish an Android binary, this is where you set up all of the Android information. And obviously, the package name is quite important because that must match the package name of the one you're going to submit to the Play Store. Which target SDKs you have? Is this a release? Do you want to allow automatic updates? Now, automatic updates is a fantastic feature because what that does is if you have a bug in the application, a bug, maybe an image that's not displaying correctly, or you're getting a logical error. By allowing automatic updates is you can automatically update applications the next time they are used without republishing to the app store. The app store rules allow you to change some information without having to resubmit it, and this enable auto updates does comply with that for both Apple and Android, which is a fantastic thing because we've had many production issues that we've picked up after we changed an API. We didn't have to go through the pain of republishing it to the App Store. It can take anything from 4 hours to a week to get your app approved, and it's very unpredictable. Right, then permissions, they're becoming very sticky on permissions. Okay, so I can tell you right now, the app stores will reject any app if you ask for permissions that are not expressly used by the app. So you need to check. So if you're not going to read SMSs, you should not request SMS functionality. Otherwise, rejected. Okay. If you do read SMSs and other messages, you need to provide a very solid justification why you need it. Right, then you've got Android features. Okay, this is if you want to allow additional features specific to Android. Bearing in mind, these three menu tabs here are specifically for Android. Okay, these functions only become valid once the app is installed on the Android. Then you've got iOS. You do exactly the same with iOS. insert the right bundle ID, you insert all of your assets. What's really helpful is that I've never had an app rejected because of incorrect assets. So this makes sure that you submit the right assets. In other words, the right icons, the right launch screens, the right screenshots to Apple to make them happy. Really good function. iOS keys, all right. So this is where you set up specific capabilities of your app. Are you going to allow it to run in the background? Are you going to allow it to be used in landscape mode? You can enable and disable certain things here. Cordova, right. So Cordova is the bridge between JavaScript and the underlying hardware on the mobile device. JavaScript cannot query a battery status natively. Cordova is the interpreter. Cordova has got a set of commands that allows you to query the hardware and use the hardware effectively. So this is actually a hybrid Cordova app. We are creating a mobile-friendly website, for lack of a better term, and we are converting that into a compiled mobile app. Some coding purists believe that that is not actually programming. They say that an application should be hybrid, I mean, should be native. What they don't understand is that the time to market for an hybrid app is about 10% of a native app, and you have half the issues, and you hit three platforms with one code base. Doesn't get more efficient than that. The type of apps we do not require graphic acceleration. It's not a game. It's not something that is entertainment for the user. It's a business app. You are being presented with information. You're consuming the information. You're modifying the information, and you're sending it back. It's perfect for that. Then, components. If you want to use Google Maps, obviously you have to insert the API key after you have set things up with Google. And this new one is my favorite, Progressive Web App. So, Progressive Web App is a mobile-friendly web application that mimics a application, installed application, once you've added it to your home screen. The beauty about this is that it gives you full functionality. Whereas Cordova, you'll find while the app runs fine in your browser and your emulator, the minute you install it on a physical device, you get differences. There is only about 80% similarity between the simulator or the emulator and actually running it on a device. And sometimes we could get stuck for days on end trying to fix a problem that is unique to iOS. Progressive Web App removes that problem because it uses the full functionality of JavaScript. So whatever happens in the browser and in the test device in the browser happens on the phone. It's brilliant. I have not found any major differences, which means that when I find a problem or something that I need to fix, I can emulate it in the browser, I can fix it, and then I can push an update to the PWA. PWA does not have to go via the App Store. The user visits a URL, adds it to the home screen, and then it effectively installs itself, and it allows offline caching as well, which means that if the handset doesn't have a data connection, it will still function as long as it doesn't require refreshed data from the server. And you can set a whole bunch of options here. Right, so that takes care of the app settings. Now, the next part that is extremely important to understand is model. So Apple relies heavily on the ability to model data. So model data is a way of describing your data structure to the IDE so that it does automatic binding. One of the big problems with working with other development applications and IDEs is that if you declare a variable, you need to remember what that variable's name is. So when you try and use it in another part of the app and you misspell it or you can't remember what it is, you need to go and look for it. So the model is a way of graphically describing how you want the data to display. And it binds it to the user interface. Last one is routing. So your routing is, it's like a menu item in Drupal. You create menu items to pages. So we are going to create custom pages, and those pages will then be routed just like a menu item. So you can decide how you want to. So when you go from one screen to another screen, you are routing from home screen to the user screen.